Hello guys and girls, and welcome back to another episode of Seb Talks Sports. That intro music and podcast theme was created by All-Pro New York Giants running back, now music creator and friend of the show, David Wilson. Go and check him out on all of his social media platforms at Four Still Running on Twitter and Instagram, and his music under David E. Wilson across all good music streaming services. He's free for business, so drop him a message if you want some beats for your podcast, advert, commercial, absolutely anything you need. Before I get into this episode, I just want to say that if you're not already following Seb Talks Sports across all platforms, then please do. You can find me on Facebook, Seb Talks Sports, YouTube, Seb Talks Sports, Twitter, at Seb Talks Sports, and Instagram, where I'm primarily active. Again, it's at Seb Talks Sports. Today, I have another incredible guest for you all. He's one of the very best defensive ends to have played in the NFL over the course of the last decade, with no fewer than 64 and a half career sacks to his name, and an unbelievable 18-sack season in 2011. It's All-Pro and 2x Pro Bowl talent, Jason Babin. Enjoy! My guest today is one of the most productive defensive ends of the last decade, an All-Pro and 2x Pro Bowler who spent 13 seasons in the NFL, racking up a total of 64 and a half sacks, including an unbelievable 18-sack season on the Eagles in 2011. It's an absolute pleasure to welcome Jason Babin to Seb Talk Sports. Jason, how are you?
Hey, appreciate you having me on today.
You got it. Thank you again for joining me. I want to start with your college career because you had a fantastic college career before turning pro as well as in the NFL, which I'll of course get to. So during your years at Western Michigan, you were a two-time MAC Defensive Player of the Year in back-to-back seasons, 2002 and 2003, a two-time first team All-MAC in those years, a second team All-American in your senior year, hold the college record for career sacks with 38 among many more records I could go into for a long time, were inducted into the Hall of Fame and played alongside fellow NFL stars Greg Jennings and Tony Scheffler, just to name a couple. So how much did you enjoy your time as a Bronco, and what was it like to share that experience with your teammates?
Well, you forgot one important accolade, Playboy All-American. That was the one I remember the most. I tell you what, it was a college experience. I'm sure any you know athlete will tell you that played beyond college is those are the years you remember the most, the ones you talk about the most. I feel like the relationships you create, the people you meet, you know, and because you're still developing and growing as a person, as who you are. And it's just such a fun time. I mean, if you go back to any time in your life, I think most people would say, like, I'm going to go back to my college years.
Yeah. How was it like on the pitch at Western Michigan?
I enjoyed it a lot. You know, to be truthful with you, I wasn't as always as goal-oriented as I am now. When I got to college, my main focus was, you know, drinking and working out and girls. And I remember when my head coach at the time, Gary Darnell, called me to his office. This was like, I think after my sophomore year, in the early part of the summer before we started training, and you know he's got a southern accent, so he's like, "Now, Jason, let me tell you something. I'm straight." And he proceeded to tell me, he said, "Listen, if you want to be in the NFL, want to have a career in the NFL, like you can do that. You have the intangibles." And I didn't work hard. I didn't do all the things you know I was supposed to do. But he was like, "Listen, you need to take it to the next level. You know, you need to live that life of an Olympian, of an All Pro. You don't need to is what you want to do." And he's like, he said to me, that's anything you do, you know, it's just how you need to be. You need to be all in on it. And I left there and it hit me like, this guy's right. You know, what do I want to do? I love doing this. I love working out. I love this. So I really literally left there and riding the elevator down. I'm like, okay, this is what I'm doing. I'm going to change. You know, I made some small changes, which, you know, obviously small changes are what make big impacts. But from that moment on, I changed the way I went about things, how I took things so much more serious. My every little detail of my life, you know, mental, physical, emotional, one singular focus. And I'm glad he had the talk with me. I might have not even noticed it, you know, just went about my life.
And obviously that decision to make that change was a huge one because on the 24th of April, 2004, the NFL draft, you're sat there at pick number 27 in the first round and then your phone rings and it's Texans GM Charlie Cassidy who trades up with Tennessee and takes you with that 27th overall pick, making you a Texan for the next 3 seasons. Can you describe that feeling for me you had when you received that call, knew you were going to be a Texan for the next 3 years, and what did it mean to you and your family?
It was one of those things where it was almost surreal, you know, you're like, okay, you know, you're living in the moment and you're so focused on, all right, this is what I got to do now. This is what's in front of me. But I think looking back, you know, it's one of those cool moments, you know, where, you know, you just take a snapshot in your brain. Like I think the photo, you know, of me sitting there, you know, on the phone with, you know, talking to Charlie and, you know, I have the Texans hat on and, you know, and I decided not to go to New York and have a party in my hometown. I have all my, you know, friends and family there. It was just one of those, like, one of those memories just you just hold dear.
Nice. So like I just said, you spent three seasons in Houston after that 2004 draft and contributed 13 sacks, 2 forced fumbles and fumble recoveries, 126 tackles and 25 tackles for loss in just 22 starts in three seasons, which is very productive, especially as such a young player. So as the team that specifically chose you to join their roster and give you the opportunity to play in the NFL, what did the Houston Texans mean to you and how much did you enjoy those first three seasons as a pro?
Well, I think it was a unique opportunity. One, because it was a brand new team.
Yeah,
maybe the third year when I was there. So unfortunately, we weren't very good. I think we were 1-15 my first year, and didn't get too much better over the next 2 years. But it was just an opportunity for me to, you know, my I wanted to get out of, you know, the small town I grew up in. I wanted to get to a big city. I wanted to experience that life, and it was just such a cool opportunity for me to do all those things. Where, you know, if you want to buy a house and start a family at, you know, age 21, it's not a real viable option, you know, most scenarios. So, you know, allowed me to do that, you know, to start my family and to get married there after, you know, once we got married, once the season was over, to my wife, Sarah. It was just such a cool thing that, you know, because of football, because of the Texans, I got to do those things.
Very nice. And then after your time in Houston, you then spent some time on the Seahawks, Chiefs, Titans, and of course, the Eagles, who I want to narrow in on a bit more. Because in 2009, you played 12 games and then rejoined the team in 2011 when you had a career year, that 18 sack season. 18 sacks in just 14 games, as well as 17 tackles for loss and 29 quarterback hits over the course of the season, which is just incredible. I know you had an excellent season in Tennessee as well the year prior, which I'll get to, but what was it specifically about that 2011 offseason that took your game to the next level? What was it you worked on and how much did you enjoy that season as a player?
Well, it was kind of a unique situation in the sense, if you go back and look, I never played linebacker in college, right? Everyone was kind of like, okay, he'll be a good linebacker. We can make him a linebacker. You know, and truthfully, I was an okay linebacker, outside linebacker, but I didn't excel, right, at that position. You know, I was okay. I was you know, adequate. And the first time I got to play defensive end was in Tennessee. So I remember the first 6 years I played linebacker. I said, hey, he's okay linebacker. You know, and then the last 7, I got to play defensive end. And to me, I wish I could go back and tell my younger self, hey, just tell every team you're only going to get drafted if you play defensive end. You know, who cares if you go in the second, third round or whatever? Because, you know, I knew I was defensive end. But, you know, you get the opportunity to get drafted the first round, you just think, okay, I'll do whatever you say, coach. You know? And being a 21-year-old kid, you don't know any better. You know, you don't have someone like Eli Manning's dad says, no, you're not going to San Diego. Like, I had no one in my corner that was my advocate like that. So, but I wouldn't change it in that sense of it made me who I was. It instilled an even deeper work ethic, an even stronger conviction to fight for what I wanted. And, you know, when I set goals to, no matter what, not give up on them. Because, you know, truth, there was a time there where people are like, okay, I guess football didn't work out for you. So we had a good career, you know, we had a good 6 years. And, you know, I said, F you. I said, I know what I can do. I just need the opportunity, damn it. And so that year was just such a validation for me, you know, like, see, I've been telling you, I mean, I didn't do anything different. Obviously I got to be around, you know, some great people in Seattle, like Patrick Kearney, to really learn how to prepare like an all pro, you know, really, really finish some of the, you know, rough edges I had, you know, and on my skill set and really learn how to be a pro day in, day out even more. But just changing positions for me was all I ever wanted.
A very, very good choice, because the year before you also had an incredible year on the Titans. 12.5 sacks, 16 tackles for loss and 27 quarterback hits, which gave you your first ever Pro Bowl induction. Let you go back the very next season when you were a second All-Pro as well. So how did it feel to head out to Hawaii those 2 years? Share the field with some of the best players to ever play. And how did it differ your first year to your second year as a Pro Bowler?
I think hanging out with like-minded people is always a good time, you know, because you'd hang out with your fellas and it's not a high stress situation, you know, get to sit by the pool or go surfing, drink some beers. It's just a good time overall. And we always stayed an extra week because it was such a long haul over there to Hawaii. 1 year we brought the kids, 1 year we didn't bring the kids. It was a good time. We hit the North Shore, hit Maui afterwards.
Very nice. Okay, so I want to touch on some of the players you've played with, because obviously being on so many teams, you've played with some fantastic talent. So just to name a few names, Andre Johnson, Eric Moulds and Mario Williams on the Texans, Sean Alexander, Deion Branch, Julian Peterson and Walt Jones in Seattle, Jamal Charles, Tony Gonzalez, Deshaun Jackson, Jason Peters, TJ2K, and then Maurice Jones-Drew, Paul Poslesny, and Uche Wanneri on my Jags right there, which I'll get to. So some unbelievable names there, some of the best to ever step on a field. But I'd love to know which of those, and of course any others you'd like to mention, would you personally say stood out to you most on the field ability-wise, and which single opponent proved most challenging throughout your career as a defensive end?
Well, I would say the answer to that question is the same person for both. Walter Jones, by far, best guy I ever played against and the best teammate ever had as far as his ability. I mean, you'd beat him in practice, you'd say, it must be a draw, you know? I just beat him that quick. I mean, the guy had his own parking spot up front, but he deserved that parking spot up front. I mean, he could just slide across the grass. And he was a great guy, too. I don't think anyone can say anything bad about him on or off the field.
Was there anything he did particularly that sort of set him apart from the other players at his position that you saw behind the scenes?
He just won every time. No, he was, you know, he was, you can't see on the screen, but he was this wide, you know, athletic, you know, he beat you to the point, you know, he had punch inside hand, outside hand, he could flip his, you know, hips. It was just, he was just a really good player overall.
Absolutely. And that is, of course, why he's in the Hall of Fame now. Very well deserved. Okay, I want to touch on some coaches quickly because you've had some tremendous coaches. Like you said earlier, Gary Darnell at college, and then some NFL names, Don Capers, Gary Kubiak, Vic Fangio, and Richard Smith in Houston, Mike Holmgren and Josh Marshall in Seattle, Sean McDermott, Mike Mularkey, and of course, the reigning Super Bowl champion head coach, the one and only Andy Reid on your time in the Eagles. So I'd love to know which of those guys in particular proved most valuable to you in your prestigious career, and is there any particular advice they gave you that stuck with you most?
You know, to be truthful, I always, especially when I was younger, had a little issue with authority. And, you know, so there were some times where I butt heads with the coaches. But some of the things that they, at the time, I always didn't understand. But now that I'm a business owner and I have a team to lead, you understand what those little things are. You know, one of the things I say for Andy Reid, you know, everyone had to have black cleats on the field. Everyone had to look the same, dress the same, same uniform, you know, and like, what's the big deal with that? With the wrong cleats, you know? And if you did, there'd be one of the assistant trainers coming running out with your cleats saying, here you go. Andy said, change these. And he'd notice that kind of stuff. And, you know, in that time I'm thinking, who gives a shit, you know, but it's the little details that make the big difference, you know, in the grand scheme of things. And they add up. Those little details, you know, precipitate into a little bigger deal and then a little bigger deal. And that's meant from a positive or a negative side. And it was one of the things that he had a standard with that and it didn't waver, you know. And obviously the guy wins, you know. So you gotta see from his perspective how important it is. And if you don't understand it, you have to trust, you know, which is sometimes for, you know, someone like myself, my personality is not the easiest thing to do.
Okay, so I'm a Jags fan, like I said at the top. So I'd love to know about your season half in Jacksonville. So while the team didn't exactly have a lot of success with regards to win-loss records during your time there, you still remained incredibly productive with 9 sacks, 5 forced fumbles, 14 tackles for loss, and 26 quarterback hits in just 21 games. So how much did you enjoy your time in Jacksonville, and how did the atmosphere surrounding the team and locker room differ from your time elsewhere?
I'll tell you how much I like Jacksonville. I live here full time, and our flagship office is here.
There you go.
It really is a great place to live. I wouldn't have even known about it if I didn't get traded here. And to be truthful, I tried to fight the trade, but I had no choice in the situation. But I'm a firm believer in everything happens for a reason. And obviously, we're proof of that now. But I really enjoyed the team there. You know, I had 2 different coaches, and obviously the second one being Gus Bradley. And my workout partner was Paul Poznosny. So, you know, and for those people that don't know Paul, he's a man of very few words. Mm-hmm. My wife would always ask me, what'd you and Paul talk about? Are you working out in the morning? I'm like, well, I really do the talking, and Paul kind of answers in nonverbal ways. But he's an unbelievable guy. And as a pilot, I mean, he's got so many off-field accolades. It's unbelievable. But he was a great teammate, and I had a lot of other guys on the team that I'm still friends with to this day. And obviously, we take care of, you know, almost all the players. You know, real estate needs their, you know, investment stuff when it comes to real estate. You know, a lot of their guys are on the league now. So I've had an opportunity to meet a lot of the younger players, and not just the Jags, but guys, you know, Dallas and Houston, Miami and Tampa. So I, you know, obviously enjoy being around those guys, but the Jacksonville situation ended up being a positive in the long run. That's for sure.
Okay, Jason, I'll end with some quick fire questions. You ready?
Oh yeah.
Let's do it. Okay, favorite takeout food?
I think you got to go with Old Faithful pizza. If I'm gonna cheat, I mean, let's do it right.
Yeah, good answer. Dogs or cats?
Dogs.
Favorite music artist?
I'm going to go with AC/DC from the way back.
Good choice. Very, very good choice. Favorite sports movie?
Rocky's a sports movie, right?
Yeah.
I'll go with Rocky.
Funniest teammate you've ever had?
Colin Jenkins.
Best locker room prank you ever saw?
Well, as we already discussed, I used to get in a little bit of trouble, and I was usually the one involved in it. We put Derek Morgan's car in the indoor parking facility for a Friday walkthrough and filled it with some substance. Jeff Fisher yelled at him, made him move it. Jeff was cool about that kind of stuff.
Awesome. Okay, how did you decide on that famous celebration of yours, the sort of Usain Bolt kind of pose?
Well, to be clear, I did it before him, but he's just more famous. And I can't dance for I'd love to do a cool move, cool dance, some little shimmy, but it looks like Elaine Bennis when I try and dance.
Okay, who's your favorite NFL player of all time?
Barry Sanders.
Nice, very good choice. And finally, who's your pick to win Super Bowl 55 in Tampa?
Now, that's predicated on that they're going to play football, right?
Yep.
I would think it would be unbelievable. Could it work out? What division is Tampa in the Patriots in? Could that be a...
Yeah, AFC, NFC. Tampa's in the NFC South and then AFC East. Pats.
I think that would be very entertaining to watch.
Who takes it?
Patriots. Plus, I'm friends with Blaine and Josh Wells, so I told them I'd come down and watch some games this year. So,
good stuff. Okay, there you go. Heard it at first, guys. Jason, thank you so much for your time today. Where can people find you across social media and also check out your real estate group?
JBabbitt93 on Instagram and RedZoneRealtyGroup.com.
Perfect. I'll make sure to leave links below and people can check you out.
All right, appreciate it. Thank you.
And there he goes, the fantastic Jason Babin. Just an absolute force to be reckoned with on the field, especially in 2011. Before I go, I want to tell you very quickly about an amazing charity football league my friend is running. On Instagram, @fantasyfootballguy is running a charity league to bring awareness to children that deal with balding, alopecia, and other similar conditions. If you could go and check out his page, @fantasyfootballguy on Instagram, and head to the link in his bio, he would very much appreciate it. I'll leave his Instagram handle down below in the description of this episode. I've got many more great guests coming very soon, so stay tuned right here on Seb Talk Sports. And to take us out as usual, here's another brilliant track by All-Pro New York Giants running back turned music creator and friend of the show, David Wilson. Catch you soon, guys.